Hello, and welcome to the Science Fiction and Fantasy Marketing Podcast, the show where we help you establish your author brand, increase the size of your audience, and sell more books. Also books. I'm Lindsay Baroker, and I'm here with my two co-hosts.
I'm Jeff Poole.
And I'm Joe Lallo.
And I believe I said I wouldn't mangle the introduction because we don't have a guest today, but apparently I can do it even on the little intro to the intro. But anyway, we are going to be answering your questions today, kind of talking about, we have a lot of questions about advertising and launch strategies. So yeah, that covers some of it. Quite a few questions. Hopefully you'll find these stuff interesting before we get into that. It's been a couple months, I guess, since we did a show, just the three of us. Do you guys have any news that you'd like to share?
Let's see, my fifth mystery is out, doing fairly decently. First audiobook was approved. Apparently it just says going to retail now. So I would imagine that translates to it's going to show up in the stores eventually here. But third audiobook just went under production. So that was kind of cool. Work progresses on my next fantasy. So things are looking good, which I actually put up as a pre-order. Going to try it out again just to see how well. It's been a while since I've done a pre-order with Amazon as well as Smashwords at the same time. We'll have to see how it works. If it works any better than the last time it did, anyways.
Now, I have a question for you because you actually pay more attention to Smashwords than I do. Is there a way to check at how many pre-orders you've gotten through them? Because I couldn't find it.
You know, when I first did it, there was a way to check, and I am still digging like crazy to try and find out where it is in there, and I have not found it yet. So maybe I can do. I shoot a message to Mark Coker or something and say, hey, if I'm curious, how do I find this out? Because I'm curious. I want to know if this is worth my time to do this, but
you can
I'm still looking.
You can get, if you look in the daily, like the whatever, the real-time daily things, there is a pre-orders tab you can hit to find just pre-orders for that. But I think it only gives you the pre-orders for like two of them. I don't think there's ever, I think it's iBooks and Kobo. I don't think that the Barnes & Noble pre-orders show up there.
And is it just for the day or is it all your pre-orders cumulative?
It's cumulative. I think it goes back, like you can go back 180 days. So okay. You can get
I'll take a look. I actually, in like 3 weeks, the book will be out, so I'll find out. But I've got the automatic email a couple times that says, congratulations, you made the hot whatever for the week sales. I'm like, oh, is that like a lot or is that three? And it was two more than anybody else made. So I don't know. But
wow. Apparently,
you have to let us know about the audiobooks, Jeff, and how it works for you. Is it your fantasy series or your mystery series?
The first one is the mystery, which is it's now been completed. The second one is a fantasy that's still being worked on. And then the guy that did the mystery said, I really love the series. Let's go ahead and do the rest of them. I'm like, okay, twist my arm. Go right ahead.
Are you doing a royalty share or are you paying?
Yeah, it's a royalty share.
Okay, well, hopefully it'll turn out well for both of you.
Here's open.
As for me, well, first off, I checked, and sure enough, you get the daily pre-order things going back 360 days now, but it looks like it's only for iBooks. Either that or I've never had a pre-order on any other place.
I'll have to check out that one as well. 360, they couldn't have extended that to 5 days to make it a full year.
Yeah, right. It's that whole, you know, months are multiples of 30, according to accountants. But all right, not my news. A couple of months ago, probably last time we did this, I had announced that I was going to start experimenting with doing monthly short story releases on the same day every month. I have decided to stop doing that after the first three. It wasn't a matter of it not working. It was working okay. It wasn't blowing my socks off in terms of increasing my ranking across the board, but it was more a logistical thing. I thought I'd given myself enough lead time to get the covers and stuff in order for the second batch of books, and the bottleneck got a little bit too tight. I didn't want to be rushing to do the release for the April release. So that's on hold, and I'll probably maybe start it up again at some point when I have a deeper pipeline ready to go. And speaking of the pipeline, I have my next steampunk book. It just came back from the editor. I'm going to be gone all week, but next week I'll be looking over the edit. I also just finished a short story, which is going to be in an anthology in a couple of months. And I have another fantasy. It's a collected edition of something I did as a serial on a website a while ago. That's going to be novelized. So I've got some stuff in the pipeline now. They all showed up at the same time, though. I wish I had spaced them out so that they would be coming out on like a 1 or 2 month interval, as opposed to both of them being done at the same time. So one will probably be on a long pre-order, and the other one will probably be released relatively quickly. And I also have three other books that are like at 60% each, because the sequence I went through was get most of the way done with something, say yes to a project that requires me to take a break, and then rather than read the first 60% of that book, just start a new one and get interrupted on that times three. So eventually, again, this is how it works. This is how eventually I end up with three things done at the same time, is I end up taking the rest of them to the last 40% over the course of 3 weeks and then have them done at the same time.
All right, now wait a minute. This is the same project you're taking three different angles on, or three different projects?
Three different projects. One of them is fantasy, one of them is sci-fi, and one of them is one of those oddballs that we'll probably be talking about. It was a bad idea in 2 years.
I just wonder, like, okay, this is doing good. Ooh, shiny object. Okay, let's go over here. Like, oh, what do you want? Okay, let's go over here.
That's so pretty much what it is. It's like, it was, if I didn't say yes to the interruption, then probably it would be done and I wouldn't have this. But it was a shiny object when I started it, and then it had lost its sheen by the time I got back to it.
Shiny object tarnished. Okay, where's the next shiny object?
Exactly. But that's the news I got.
All right. Yeah, we were talking about it before the show, how we have to learn how to say no. And I feel bad, Joe, because I wasted, I think maybe one of your projects might have come from me backing out on something. Because I'm kind of, you know, like we had that conference in Oregon, and I was all excited too to try the short stories every month and try new things. But, you know, as reality hits, I'm kind of like, you know, the best use of my time is just, as I've seen, to like write a series, 5-6 books, whatever it ends up being, kind of do the rapid release and then coast off of the momentum for that and maybe take a vacation. I've heard people do things like that in between and then start a new series and just not worry about a whole lot of other little stuff. But because I have several older series that I'm trying to eventually come bring to a conclusion, I have other things I need to do in addition to just you know, like writing the new series and focusing on that. But going forward, that's what I hope to do after I get caught up with some of the back stuff that I need to wrap up and resolve for my poor readers that have been hanging for 2 or 3 or 4 years. I did finally finish up one series last year, so that was cool. But this year I'm working on Chains of Honor 3 is my next one after I finish an anthology for a project I said yes to. And, you know, like you, I tend to say yes because it's like 9 months before the due date. And so I'm like, oh, yeah, I got plenty of time. I'll slip that in. And by the time it actually gets to, like, I have to work on it, I'm just, like not in the mood because I'm more interested. Like, in this case, this is for my pen name of romance. And I'm not really in the romance mood right now. I've been doing the fantasies and the dragons. And so it's been really hard to shift over back into an old world, even though I think once it's done, I'll enjoy the story. Right now, I'm just like, oh, kisses, smooches. Yeah, I'd rather just kill somebody and, you know, have an explosion. Not that the two cannot happen at the same time. But so that's kind of my news, too. I finished up my Heritage of Power series with 5 books a little over a month ago. Things have tapered off now, which is what I expected. You know, like I said last time I talked about it, I cut off all the advertising after the first 2 weeks, other than letting Amazon ads, got a couple of those. I just let them run. They don't cost me very much. You know, if I was smart, I'd go in and tinker and launch a new one each week and try to really keep the ads showing, because I noticed early on I was actually able to spend quite a bit and make, you know, sales. And then they kind of got stale after a while and they're not getting as many clicks and impressions now. But I've talked about before how I kind of focus on a series when I launch it, and then once I wrap it up, I'm ready to move on to the next thing. And I, of course, I'll try to get BookBub ads and occasionally do sales on the first book as things go on. But and I'll probably do a box set eventually too, something we're going to talk about with one of our questions here in a little bit. I think that's most of my news for me. I'm just going to be trying to streamline things a little bit, I think, going forward and focus on doing like 1 or 2 big series a year, or not even that big necessarily. I like that 5-6 book mark. Thinking you can tell a pretty good story without necessarily running out of steam and getting bored with it. And that's just my personality. I've got 2 that are at 8 books, 3 that are at 8 books, and they were good. They were fine. And now I'm done with them. But I don't know, 5 or 6, like you can finish. I can finish pretty quickly. So I enjoy that. All right. Do you guys have anything else about yourselves or your books you'd like to talk about before we jump into questions?
I don't.
I guess the only other thing is if you hear a baby during my portion of audio, it's because my brother and sister-in-law just had a kid and he is upstairs right now.
So, all right. I've got the usual dogs that could, they actually walked in and clattered and stuff while Joe was talking. So
yeah, my dog is here, not too noisy, but demanding. So if I vanish, you'll know why.
All right. Well, let's just jump into our first question. These are, I just thank you guys on Twitter for giving me a bunch of questions today because I was like, I'm not sure we have enough to talk about on the show today, but now it's going to be like, can we get through all these questions? All right, first it's from Dale. Your thoughts on the pros and cons of writing in more than one subgenre at the same time. In my case, I'm looking at a heroic fantasy trilogy alongside my upcoming urban fantasy series.
Well, I can tell you, mine's not the subgenre. It's just two different genres completely. And the first time I tried it, I tried writing one of my epic fantasies as well as the mysteries I'm doing at the same time. And I'm pretty sure I smelt the burnt wiring up here. So it took me a while to get, I added from one frame set to the other in the same day. So it's difficult. You can do it, but for me, it was difficult. Second time around I did it, I was much more organized. So as long as I had everything outlined, oddly enough, in one and the other, then that way I don't have to question myself when I start thinking about it. Just here's what I need to cover in this one, here's what I need to cover in that one, and it's good to go.
I think the pros of doing multiple subgenres is that, you know, potentially you have a wider audience for you, the author, not the individual books. And, you know, it might keep your brain a little bit fresher because you're able to not necessarily get bored of a certain thing. You're always going back and forth. I think the con is that all things being equal, you can write a single series more quickly than a simultaneous series. So if you're looking for a rapid release and stuff like that, you're going to either have a smaller number of books over a larger period of time or just a longer amount of time before you can bank enough books to do a rapid release. So if you're looking for speed, I think it'll hurt you, but otherwise it's, you know, probably worth trying.
Yeah, I would kind of echo what Joe said there. I started out doing a couple of different series and alternating because it seemed like a good idea, and I don't know. I found, though, that I'm much more efficient and my brain seems to like it more when I do the whole series at once, just write them back to back to back without taking breaks. It's easier for me to keep everything in my head, and it's just easier. Sometimes it's hard. I've talked about before that it's hard to go back and work on something else when you've got a shiny new idea here. And I feel like if you're trying to work on two series at the same time, you might set yourself up for that, where like one becomes more exciting and then you have a hard time going back and finishing the other one. But it's just going to depend on your writing style. I know some people do love to jump back and forth like that. As Joe was saying, for the release, I don't think you're going to do yourself any favors if you're trying to kind of alternate releases. I think I've certainly seen in the last few years, as on Amazon in particular, that doing the rapid release with the one series and getting them out quickly without letting the momentum die is it just tends to be more profitable overall and gathering more fans. I don't know. It just seems to really, if you can keep from falling off the cliffs or whatever there, and just, you know, you're going to probably get most traction with your first book. And then if your book has fallen to 100,000 in the store, when you release your next one, you're kind of forcing it back up, you know, trying to do some sales, and it can work, but it's harder if you're just able to keep the momentum going all along by releasing a new one in the series every month. Obviously not everybody's going to be able to do that, but that's why I really think it's great to bank them and then just hold it. Even if you're waiting a year, you know, I probably wouldn't wait more than that, but if you have to wait a while to work on them, I would do that right now, and you're welcome to ignore me and do it your own way. But yeah, I think it would be, I don't know, Joe, you kind of do this. You kind of alternate still with the series. And do you find that you're starting over each time because it's been a year since a new installment?
Yeah, especially recently, I feel like alternating series the way I do is turning into a losing battle. I think I was just, again, before we went on mic, I was talking about how I might have to revise my methods a little bit because things are slowing down. It's like, yeah, there's no such thing as momentum in my sales thing. I have a slow burn on a lot of series right now, and if you have a long enough series, you can make the money. But I definitely feel like I would be doing better if I was focused on a single thing and just sort of let people know, don't worry, that stuff will be back, but here's this series for now.
Yeah, so you can do it. But, you know, if it's, especially you mentioned one is just a trilogy, maybe focus on that and put that out and then switch to the urban fantasy. I think you'll find that you have some readers that will read both genres and be interested in both things from you. And then you'll have some readers that kind of get, they glom onto one series, or they only like your urban fantasy, or they only like your heroic fantasy and won't be eager to cross over. So I, even though they're both under fantasy, I wouldn't count on one like building your readership for the other, just in case that was in mind.
Yeah, two subgenres like that, you pretty much have to assume that the readers of one will not necessarily transfer over to the other. I noticed that with the, I just planned on that when I did the mysteries, like, you know, as you guys were saying, is it was a good one. If you started getting feeling stale in the one, like in mine, I was like, okay, I love the fantasies, I love the dragons. Man alive, I could use to do something a little bit different. I started up the mysteries, and that was a lot of fun. But I noticed as soon as I got about 2/3 of the way through the mystery, I was like, ooh, I've got some ideas about the fantasy. Let's finish this up and jump back over to the fantasy. So for me, it worked.
Yeah. I love having both the space opera too and the fantasy, because once I, just like Jeff, you know, I'll get the itch after a while. Let's go play with spaceships for a little while.
Who can I kill now? Who pissed me off lately? But
I can do that in any genre, though. Sweet romance? Oh, we can work a little murder in there. All right. Next question is from Maureen. Do you have an ad strategy for launching a book?
I usually my ad strategy, I'll usually, if I get one, I'll, especially if it's in a series and it's not the first in a series, I'll usually release an ad for the first one, start building a momentum. And then this is probably about 2 weeks, 3 weeks before the release date of the new one. And then when the new one comes out, I'll do like a Facebook ad or something. Just starting to, you know, dip my toe back in that water, and so far it's done all right.
Yeah, for me, I don't really have that much of an ad strategy. What I'll do is, my launch is strategy is normally to have a reasonably lengthy pre-order e-arc period, and then a couple of promoted posts for the actual launch, and then ads after I've got a dozen or so reviews. But then again, I haven't started a new series in a while, so most of my ad strategy is still dealing with directing people to the series starter. So I'm sure it would be different if I was launching something from scratch.
Yeah, I won't necessarily spend much or any money. I'll do like a boosted post for a later book in a series. But when I'm starting a new series, that's kind of when I'll actually put effort, more effort into like planning things and really trying to get enough sales. I try to spread it over like a couple weeks, because that seems to be what Amazon likes. Like, if you can steadily get sales over a couple weeks, then just seems like more likely they're going to start promoting you. You know, everybody talks about the algorithms, you know, and they notice, you know, it's part being appearing in other also bots and just appearing and having more links to your book from the rest of the store. But they do actually send out emails, you know, weekly, here's what's new in your genre. And sometimes it's just tailored to the person's taste, like if they've bought your books before, but they do actually send out ones that are just to like everybody that signed up to receive the sci-fi emails. So if you do well enough, you might get some of that kind of promo stuff. And so, and I will say, this is for a book one in a series for me. Like, if it's just a book, I would probably just like, and I'm not counting, it's okay to be a loss leader if it's a book one and there's five more books coming. But if it's a stand, if it was a standalone book, I'd probably only spend maybe $100 promoting it and try to book like e-reader news today. And, you know, I can't even remember who all does the Fussy Librarian. There's a five or six kind of sponsorship sites that aren't too expensive and that will take a launch book. Is, you know, they want it to be on sale. So if you do like a 99-cent launch, that's going to work for them. And then a lot of times, once you get the momentum going, you can raise the price, especially if you're in Kindle Unlimited and people can just borrow it if they don't want the $4.99 price tag. So a lot of times, like if it's just a standalone book, that's what I do. Try to spread it out. You know, like one day you're going to do your newsletter to your mailing list. And if it's a big list, maybe you want to kind of split it over 3 days, segment it and send it out to kind of build momentum, and then try to have some ads coming in the next couple of days. Just spread it out a little bit if you can, rather than throwing everything on one day. And like I said, if it's a book one in a series, I'm willing to spend more money. I've mentioned before, I spend like $2,000-$3,000 in January on my Heritage of Power series, because I saw it was selling well, so it was worth putting more money into it. And I already had books 2 and 3 out at full price. So, and that's when I'll also throw in like the Facebook ads, the AMS ads, and the BookBub pay-per-click ads. And I watch them really carefully because, as I mentioned on the show before, depending on the genre, depending on the cover, the ads you put together, sometimes one of those won't perform well and you might as well cut it early if you're not getting a lot of sales from the clicks. So, and but those pay-per-click kind of ads can really keep things going once you've run out of things that like you run out of the e-reader news todays. And, you know, so, but then after a couple of weeks, it's either going to like fly on its own, or if you turn off the ads, it's going to sink. And then you can decide, because at that point, I'm just usually let it sink. But we've had people on the show that are willing to spend $2,000-$3,000 a month to make $7,000 a month, and that makes perfect sense. So you just kind of keep a real eye on how much you're spending versus how much you're making. So, all right. Next question from Maureen. Do you have, and how do you manage street teams?
Street teams being defined like just a group of people designed to help you out with beta reading or just input,
well,
that sort of thing?
People that are going to sell your book for you, usually, I think the romance community has them a lot. They're like handing out bookmarks, handing out free stuff. They might be your reviewers, but they're actually really people you've kind of recruited to help promote your books.
Yeah, I've got my own little team that I've managed right through a Facebook secret group that, you know, handles like beta reading, promoting, that sort of thing. I don't have anybody that's out like giving away bookmarks or just, you know, stuff like that. So I don't know if that's the same thing, but that's just my own personal team. I do everything right through Facebook, the secret group.
Yeah, I don't have a terribly active street team. I do have a review crew sort of thing. Similarly, I have two different groups. I got the beta readers, which is not a street team in any stretch of the term, but they're in a secret Facebook groups because I tend to have a little bit more feedback back and forth between them. And then for like the review crew and stuff like that, I use MailChimp and I use the VIP tag, and I'll do a segmented list of addresses for those people and send out, you know, here's the new thing, you know, read it. This is going to be released in 2 months. Be ready for it, that sort of thing. So a mailing list segment and a secret Facebook group are how I handle that sort of thing.
Yeah, I think the secret Facebook group is probably one of the easiest ways because most of your people are going to be on Facebook right now. And you can recruit right from your author page if you want to get people, or from your mailing list. I do not do a street team, never have. Just it sounds like a lot of work, to be honest, and a lot of interacting with people, which we all know if you listen to the show. I have those heavy introvert tendencies. And I also, honestly, I really hate to ask for favors. I almost never ask anybody for help if I can avoid it. And to me, that's asking for a favor. Review things, you're giving them a book in exchange for a review. It seems more of an equitable trade fair deal rather than asking someone to spend time promoting your stuff. And that's just me because I don't like to bother anybody. And I have done the review teams. I actually didn't for my last launch. I was just a little bit, not so much burned out on it, but Amazon kept like deleting people's reviews. You kept hearing about this, and it just, and they kind of bury the unverified reviews, meaning that if people didn't purchase it, their reviews, people have to go looking for it. Like I don't know how it is right now this month, but for a while that you had to actually select that you wanted to see unverified reviews when you were looking at a book's review. So I just said, well, let's just throw this one out there and see how it does. And what was interesting was that I got quite a few reviews the first day from the Patreon people who got advanced copies of the book, which makes perfect sense because they'd have 2 weeks to review it. I mean, to read it. And I didn't ask for reviews, but you know, I probably got like 5 or 10 just from them doing that. So that was great. That was like a review team. And again, I don't like to ask, so I didn't, but it's really up to you. I feel that though for reviews, we need less than we think we do. Like if you've got 15 or 20, you're probably got enough to get on all the advertising promo sites, you know, BookPub, maybe they want to see more, but I've also seen them promo stuff where there weren't a lot of reviews. So, and they specifically say you don't have to have like 100 reviews or anything. But yeah, so I don't do street teams. Sounds like the guys don't quite do it. Although there's nothing wrong with it. Again, it's how extroverted you are and how many, if you want to manage people. I actually found it kind of tedious just to even manage a review team, because all the questions you get back when you email them, and I can't get it on my Kindle. And yeah, it's easier now with BookFunnel, but yeah, it was just easier not to do it. And but when you're starting out, obviously it's harder to get people. And if you're starting a new series or in a new genre, you know, it's hard not to get reviews, have them lined up on day one. So I don't think there's anything wrong with the review team. Just be aware that Amazon is, if they, who knows what, why, sometimes they review it because they think it's a friend or a relative, close connection. I mean, they delete it. So don't get too frustrated if some of them get deleted. All right, moving on to NAK. I'd like to hear your views on Amazon closing its submissions to Kindle Scout. And it sounds like they're kind of closing the whole program or just letting it coast with what's published now.
I've never used it. I've never subscribed to it. So I can't really offer too much of an opinion on that.
As for me, it doesn't surprise me. It struck me as being a little bit too redundant to be anything more than an experiment for them, because they already have traditional publishing and they already have indie publishing. And this was sort of a way to upgrade people from indie to traditional with a little bit of, you know, social media aspect to it, I suppose. But they don't really need to do that. They also have a means to keep people exclusive. So they have all of the tools necessary that people can use individually. Combining them into a little pseudo contest struck me as a weird combination and maybe a fun experiment, but fun experiments eventually come to an end. And I had no strong feelings for or against Scout. I never used it, but it seemed like it wasn't going to last forever from when I'd first heard about it.
I also never used it, although we've had a couple people on the show that have had books in there and they did well. I think that you probably, Amazon didn't get any real knockout bestsellers out of it. I haven't heard of any if that happened. And they may have found that it's just more efficient for them to just go through and cherry pick and pick people from the top 100 lists and offer them contracts if they want them on their team. So, and plus when they do that, they already know the book has a, you know, they're like, oh, this book already has 500 reviews and it's been selling for 2 years. They tend to pick stuff like that for like 47 North is the sci-fi and fantasy arm of their publishing. So I'm guessing they just were finding that it wasn't that profitable overall for them. I think they were footing the bill on the covers and the editing. Does that sound right? So maybe they didn't have enough knockout hits to make it worthwhile. All right, next question is from Edward. Have any of you taken advantage of the above $9.99 threshold of 70% royalty at Kobo with complete series in one ebook? And if so, how are the results?
I personally have not tried that.
I think I may have been in one or two collections that were priced higher than the $10. And I mean, them being collections, you know, I made a couple of dozen dollars off of it because I was one of the many authors that was in it. But as far as I know, it has a reasonably good return on investment if you use it well enough. But as just a fraction of a fraction, I didn't really have any life-changing experiences.
I haven't done it yet either, but I'm all prepared to do it after. Joanna Penn's the one who often talks about having good luck with her box sets, like the whole series for $24.99 or something like that in Kobo. So I've actually had an 8-book box set put together of my Dragon Blood series, but I'm about to release the 8th book, so I want to wait till it's been out for a while before I make the whole series available for a deal. So that will probably be maybe like late summer or fall, and I will throw it up there for maybe $24.99, because I think the individual books are all $3.99 or $4.99 US, except for the free first one. So whatever ends up being a deal of like $3 off or something for the readers. And then because I now have the spinoff series, Heritage of Power, I can put it at the end of book 8. If you enjoy these, here's another series. And again, that's in exclusive with Amazon for now. But as with my last series, I will take it out when I'm getting geared up to put a new series, launch a new series, and put it out everywhere. Because as we've talked about before, you get emails from people who are like, why is this not on Kobo? All your other stuff is on Kobo. I'm like, it's coming. So I don't know, ask again in a year, Edward, and I can let you know. I may try once I do that, running a few ads very specifically to Kobo, to that box set, and see if it ends up being profitable because you could spend quite a bit if you were taking home 70% on $19.99 or $24.99. So I can see where it makes sense. All right. Also from Edward, he would love to know our thoughts on hardcover omnibuses of series through Ingram Spark. Also, is it worthwhile or possible to create large print and regular editions of the same book through KDP Print?
Yeah, I read his second question here. I was like, ooh, I want to know too. Because I have, you know, several people that were like, have you ever considered releasing, you know, like in the hardcover or like a special edition sort of thing? And I was like, that'd be cool. And I haven't really given it much thought on what service I would use to do it. But if any of you two have used it, I'd like to hear it too.
I have not used it to create hardcovers yet. I have considered it. There's a small but vocal portion of my readership who are after hardcovers, and specifically hardcover box sets, like literally in like a sleeve, which is not possible via Ingram Spark. But I don't know at this point, because of the small number of people and the specific way they want it, I'd be more inclined to actually do a hardcover run and satisfy just the almost Kickstarter wise, just satisfy, create a run for the people who actually want it and give it to them. Because I think the hardcover stuff and print on demand tends to be pretty pricey. As for the large print and regular editions, I'm pretty sure you can do it. And when we did the Oregon Coast thing, there are people who believe you should have, as an indie, you should be able to supply everything that a publisher would, because people were buying it from the publisher and therefore could be buying it from you. So it might be worthwhile, especially if it's, you know, print on demand and just not costing you anything but the setup. That said, I don't sell enough regular paperback to think that I would need to fragment my paperback, you know, products into large print and regular. So your mileage may vary on that.
Yeah, that's probably a better answer than I would give. It's not something I've really thought about doing, just because, first of all, I publish so much that it's a pain in the butt just getting the paperback out there. I'm usually like 6 months behind, and three people have to ask where the paperbacks are before I get the files uploaded. And that, you know, I've got two books so far in Ingram Spark in the series that I've got in the five up on CreateSpace, just because it's a little extra time I got to do. I suppose this would be a VA kind of thing if I did that. But so far, you know, this kind of thing would be mostly, I think, if you're into going to like cons and you want to sell physical copies and you want maybe something that's not available just from Amazon. Because we had, oh shoot, I forgot his name, that talked about the conventions back in December, and that he did that. He kind of made these special, you could only get this at the convention. And yeah, it's $30 and I'm signing it. So, and that's not a bad deal, especially as Edward was saying, if you did like a whole omnibus. I think maybe a trilogy might be as much as you could get, depending on how thick you write into a paperback or a hardback. You know, but my 8-book series, I don't think that I could do it. I'd have to do like what Joe was talking about, put it in a sleeve and have the books. And I don't know who does that. Or if anybody knows more than we do, you're welcome to come to the comments. I think this is episode 175, we decided. And let us know your experience on that. Because if you do the conventions, it totally makes sense to have some cool physical copies. Or just like Joe was saying, if you want to do a limited edition run and you have some fans that would enjoy that, might be something worth looking into.
You know darn well, if we ever do release a hardcover of any of our books, we're going to have to figure out how to make a really cool sleeve to go along with it, because you know that question will be coming. Yeah, I've got hardcovers. Cool. What's the sleeve look like? Damn it. So, got to be ready.
Yeah, you'd have to go back to your cover designer and say, okay, I need these little flaps. I don't know. Maybe you can do hardcovers for that.
And they will go, ka-ching, I'll get right on that.
Yeah, it would be an extra $100 for the hardcover edition. All right, and also Edward was asking, what are your thoughts in terms of wide or exclusive when it comes to audiobooks and Audible? And at what let me divide it up. Let's answer that. Joe, you're the only one I think that's gone wide with any audiobooks. So what are your thoughts so far on that?
I like going wide with audiobooks. First off, I just recently moved over one. I have two now on both. I have two audiobooks that are wide, and both of them are on Findaway Voices now. And, you know, you make an extra couple of bucks a month from that, and it's just free money that you wouldn't have been getting otherwise. But mostly, I think the thing about going wide with audiobooks that I almost wish I had done all of my own stuff self-produced is there are a lot of people. If you have complete control over your audiobook, you also can promote it in ways that people aren't thinking of doing. The guy from Story Bundle in the past has expressed interest in doing an audiobook bundle, but the problem is everybody goes exclusive with their audiobooks. There's just not enough people with indie self-produced audiobooks that are able to put it in a bundle. So if I'd had more than two books and they were closer to the beginning of the series, I feel like I could have probably done some cool stuff with them. So I like going wide and I like having control over the all of the books, including the audiobooks.
I'm going to have to decide with the next series that I want to produce on my own, or, you know, hire my own narrator, because this has all sort of become a thing just since I haven't had like a new series put into production of audiobooks since Find a Way Voices and I think Kobo and Smashwords. I think I even saw something about upload your audiobook now if you want.
Smashwords, so, yeah, we'll upload straight to Find a Way Voices now.
Yeah, they're looking to Find a Way.
So I haven't yet done it because Audible ACX really doesn't pay that much for the exclusive. I don't make a whole lot on each sale of audiobooks. I don't know that there's that big of a difference between 25% and 40%. So I'd certainly be interested in trying it out. Although after listening to Robin and Michael Sullivan, I kind of want to go and pitch some audiobook producers with the next series that I'm not obligated to give to anybody else, just to see if I could get a big advance and let them do it and not worry about it at all. So, but I also looked after the show at Michael's review count on Audible, and he has like 17,000 reviews on his. So he's got a slightly proven track record of doing really well in audio. I don't know if they'd look at my reviews and be like, eh, whatever. We'll give you $50.
That's insane.
Yeah, I have one box set that has over 1,000 reviews on Audible, and that's been a good seller for me, but nothing else comes anywhere close. All right, last thing from Edward. Joe, you should share your Kindle World / Kindle Unlimited success story today. I think you could almost afford a coffee by now.
I looked. They actually updated for February sales, and my Kindle Unlimited Kindle World's earnings for February was like $15. So I can order three coffees with that. But that's just the Kindle Unlimited Kindle World, like the KWKU. For overall for Kindle Worlds, I made like $63. So that's a lot of coffee. And more, you know, the reason this is a thing is because the first month of KWKU, I made like 93 cents. So we were interested to see if it was going to continue to grow. And it seems like it jumped up a fair amount since then.
That was actually pretty impressive, because I was telling Joe before the show, I sure haven't promoted my sci-fi at all this last 6 months or whatever, because I've been over in Fantasy World and I haven't had any new releases in the Fallen Empire series. So I'll see what happens. I told you I'm probably going to do space opera for my next big project this summer or fall. So hopefully I can get things flowing. I keep trying to get a book bub for Star Nomad again, but you know, they gave me one once and now they're like, forget you, we got other books to promote. So I hope you guys will make money from that. All right, next question, thought, is from Kat. One thing that came up on a recent panel was, is Facebook presence for writing stuff worth maintaining if you're not putting money into advertising there? Jeff would be muted. Jeff is talking.
Yeah, I just noticed that the thing just popped up on my screen. You are muted, dummy. Unmute. And I was thinking, it's a good question. I'd like to know the answer to that one, too.
I find that Facebook, probably in terms of, it depends. I don't run advertising on my Facebook stuff, but when I do Facebook posts, I tend to get a fair amount of feedback on it. Interaction and engagement, or whatever what words they're going to use. So it's got some utility for me. I find when I need to ask like a poll type question, Facebook tends to have the greatest return. So it might not translate into a huge amount of sales, but it's still a way to keep your community engaged and to actually have interaction with them. So I find that there's still some use to being present on Facebook.
Me too. I was not a Facebook fan. It actually took me, it took me about 8 or 9 months to get an author page up there after I started publishing. And that was about my third book in the series came out then. And I actually remember I told Kat this on Twitter, that I had people that were like, oh my gosh, you're finally here. I was looking for you. That Facebook, you know, it's like a place where maybe people who won't sign up for your mailing list, who aren't into Twitter, who aren't following on Google Plus, Facebook might be where they hang out. And because there are people that just spend a couple hours there, and it's almost like that's their gateway to the internet. Or they don't even care if they get on the internet. There's games to play, people to chat with, and they expect their favorite author to be on there too. And so I would, you know, and it's not a huge time sink, I don't find, just to maintain my author page. I usually 2-3 times a week, I post whatever news I have, or if I'm working on something, a lot of times I just do snippets of the current project. You know, if I'm writing or editing, if an audiobook is coming out, I'll post it. I try to not make it all promotional stuff, just fun stuff. I don't go hunting for things to post most of the time, unless it's like, oh, it's been a week since I put anything on there. Let me go see if Wired has any interesting stories about robotic dolphins or something that my readers might be interested in. But so I don't put a whole lot of time into it. I think you can get away with just like 2 or 3 posts a week on a Facebook author page. And I do think that it's worth it because, like I said, you have people there that won't sign up to your mailing list, and that's where they're going to find their news of your new release. And I, even though there's all these things about, oh, you know, Facebook, they're not showing as many of your posts to people. If you can get them to engage by asking a question or just by writing something that they want to comment on, they will see your posts. It's, you know, if they, the more you engage, you've kind of seen that, I'm sure, with your own stuff. You always see the stuff of someone that gets a lot of engagement, however, even if they're manipulating it and asking controversial questions. I actually have muted a couple of people because they do that. It's not much to do with their writing, but that's a tangent. I would definitely have a page there and post at least a couple times a week. I get a lot of sales from Facebook when I have a new book out. I use the affiliate link, and when I do a boosted post, I do one every time for a release, but it's just to my people who like my page. Like if it's a book 4 in a series, I'm not going to pay to promote to somebody that's not already a fan. And I'll get like hundreds of sales from my Facebook page. So I've certainly found it to be worth it. All right, Felicity. Jeff always asks authors, if you could do anything differently when you start out, what would you do? I would like to know what Jeff would do differently if he could go back in time.
Oh, that's easy. Start up the newsletter, maintain it. when people, you know, I started and I had a lot of people coming to the website just saying hello. I could have been collecting email addresses then. I didn't. So that's the number one thing I would do. Number two is actually would just seriously, consistently keep writing. Because my first book, on and off, about 10 years. So I'm sure I could do a lot more in that time if I just would have maintained it all the way through. So that would be my answer. Newsletter and be consistent and keep writing.
All right. Joe, would you like to answer the same question?
also newsletter. I did not have a newsletter set up when I did my first release, and I had a pretty good couple of months of promotion early on, like back because I did a free book back when nobody was doing free books. So blogs that are out of business now were picking it up and getting me 25,000 downloads. So if I had had a little link into a newsletter, I would have had a much healthier list right now. And the other thing is, just to tie into what we were saying earlier, I probably would focus on doing a full, satisfying, complete series of 6 to 8 books before going to another genre, as opposed to my alternating thing. Because if I'd done that, right now I would have, you know, a dozen books in the Book of Deacon thing under my belt and out of the way, and I would be doing a hardcore launch on my sci-fi right now, and then in 2 years I'd have my free rent stuff, as opposed to the same number of books stretched out over that same amount of time with zero momentum. So focus, I think, would be the word that I would send back to my past self.
That's very hard to do, though. Authors we're artists, man. We got to go with the shiny, exciting stuff. For myself, I don't have too many regrets. I have definitely jumped series and jumped genres a little bit. I've got a contemporary mystery out there that, like, every now and then I'll get an email, when are you going to do more of these? And like, I think you're the only one that bought it, you and my mom and some people that live in the area. But I don't know. I don't think I don't have that focus. I can focus for long enough to write 3, 4, 5 books in a row, which is what I'm trying to do now. I think what I regret is actually not switching to that method early on where you write like the first 3 before publishing anything, because I have a lot of the series I have now that have stopped are ones where I kind of tell people like, oh, they didn't make much money, because that's really easy to understand and people understand we have to make a living and stuff. But it's often more that, because actually my Rust and Relics books, the launch went really well, I remember. But it was a different style for me. It was first person, contemporary Earth setting. And I got a lot of feedback from readers that were like, oh, we don't like this. This is not how you write. And I'd go back to the other stuff. And I think if I'd written the first three or four books before really publishing anything and was committed to it, I would have finished the series. And that's why I'm liking that now. Aside from the Amazon algorithms, blah, 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 you can get more momentum and stuff if you launch rapidly. I have a hard time staying motivated when I get negative feedback. I'll say that. I'm still very sensitive to that kind of thing. And it is amazing to me the emails that people will write you, essays deconstructing why this was not a good book. And I'm like, we've never met. I don't know why you feel you should write me this, but you've just like really killed my enthusiasm for this. And it can be really hard to recover from something like that. And sometimes it's still a good book. It's just that they weren't the right reader for that book, but it's hard to work your way through that and understand it and still stay excited about the project in the face of some negative feedback from readers who would just prefer it if all you wrote was Emperor's Edge books or all you wrote was Dragon Blood books. So I don't know what I could tell myself there, except do the thing where you write most of the series or at least half of the series before you even worry about releasing anything. So next question from Andrew, what's the best launch plan when you have multiple books pre-written in a series? Just what we're talking about. Should you release them all at once, weekly, monthly, ?
As it is very effectively proven, I am not the one to ask on this one.
My understanding, and I pieced this together based upon a lot of input from a lot of places. Let's say that you have five books written. It seems like the popular notion that I have, and this may have fallen out of vogue already, is to do about your first three very rapidly, if not on the same day, within several days of each other, and then release the remaining two or the remainder of the series between 2 and 3 weeks apart, less than 30 days, so that you don't have that cliff. So yeah, very rapid release for the first three, and then a slightly longer delay in between the others so that you can stretch out the thing. That's my understanding.
And I've just done this with Heritage of Power, and I've now done about four series like this where I kind of wrote the first three and then started writing the fourth one as I was releasing the early ones. And I have not done it all on the same day, and I wouldn't, and this is why, because it takes a couple weeks. Those first couple weeks, you're just shoving the boulder up the hill. Like I said, you're trying to get an ad here, a newsletter announcement here. And it takes a couple weeks for Amazon to, if it's going to start kind of promoting the book on its own. And for the moment, it's kind of hard. Even if you get a spike and you're up to 200 in the store based off of your newsletter list, it tends to fall back a little bit, and then you got to do something else and get a spike, and maybe eventually it'll settle at 200 for a month or so. But it seems to take a little while for most people, unless if you just have such a tremendously sized audience out there that they're all going to go buy it. I would probably do book one on day one, and you can go ahead and put the pre-order up, so that you have a link at the back of book one. Here's book two, buy it now. You might put the first chapter of book two in there. And book two, 2 weeks later, book three, 2 weeks after that. I did all three of my Heritage of Power within a month. So, and I thought that worked really well. I had all three of them were like in the top 500-600 on Amazon there for a while. And then then I think you can maybe slow down. You don't have to if you wrote the whole series and want to just put it out. You know, one thing, as you guys saw when I shared my earnings from that, obviously if you release a bunch of books at once and they do well, you're going to make a bunch of money. You know, maybe that's your release for the year. Maybe you do it once a year and that's it. And then you're just doing little stuff throughout the rest of the year. But then, you know, if you can keep it going a month apart, I did notice that I was a little over a month before I got book five out. It didn't help that February was a short month. So, and things were slowing down by then. So, you know, I was like, oh, that's probably good that this is wrapping up the series. They're still selling well enough that, I mean, I think I'm still in the top 100 for Epic Fantasy with several of them. So it's not like it's tanked, but I meant, like I said before, I've stopped doing any kind of advertising except for there's an Amazon ad going. So, you know, a month apart afterwards, it depends on how many you've written, how fast you can write, how many you put in the bank before you start releasing them. But I'd probably do the first three, like 2 weeks apart. And definitely, I say, as I probably didn't do this in every book, but a pre-order to the next one or a link to the next one in the back of the first book. All right. William, how long do you keep an AMS ad running? How do you know when to kill it?
I personally have not used an AMS ad, so I have to defer to someone who has.
Been a while since I did an AMS ad. You keep it running for as long as it is got a reasonable return on investment, and you kill it when it drops below that. How you define what a reasonable return on investment is and how to make sure that you're going to have a high one in the first place is the art that I have not yet learned. So I'll be working on that in the months to come.
Right. We've got a show back in from last summer, I think, on Amazon ads. So I will make a note to myself to put a link to that podcast, Amazon Ads Podcast, because that was a lot of great information, a lot better than you'll get from me. This last series was kind of the first one where I really saw a real noticeable amount of sales, hundreds of sales from the AMS ads. In the past stuff, I've done okay, but not... Like, I could never get as many impressions and sales as I wanted to get. I was willing to spend all kinds of money with Amazon if only they would spend more than $20. And this was the first series where it worked pretty well for me. And I've certainly known people that have lower A costs, the average cost of sale. But I was around 150% with my 99-cent book ones. So keep that in mind. On a $3.99 book, it's going to be easier to get under 100%, which is what you need. Well, not technically, because if you're in Kindle Unlimited, it gets more complicated because they don't report borrows. So I just figure for every sale, there was probably a borrow one there too, meaning I probably was under 100% even at 99 cents for that book. But how long you keep it running? You know, I still have the ones I've set up for book ones from 2 years ago, I still have running. There's one series under my pen name where it was just, they never really seemed to work very well. So I just killed those. You know, if your A cost or whatever is 800%, obviously you're probably losing money there no matter how long your series is. And, I actually only check in about once a month, if that, honestly, unless I'm actually launching a book and tinkering and adding new ads. What you'll probably find is what I've found is that you get, I guess you're just going to get fewer impressions and fewer clicks after a while on an ad. Maybe there are people out there where it's different, but even the ones I had that did pretty well the first month or two have kind of tapered off. The A cost is still the same, so that hasn't fallen off, but I just find that there's fewer impressions. So what you're probably going to need to do is keep making ads, and then you can just cancel the old ones or let them run if you want. But if it's profitable, keep it going. I don't usually do it on subsequent books. I find it weird when I see like book 12 in somebody's series advertised, because as a reader, I would just never, I'm like, book 12, I'm not going to start there. I was mad because BookBub sent me a Raymond Feist book yesterday or the day before. And I was like, oh, I used to love his book. So I went and grabbed the sample. I'm cheap, right? I'm not going to pay the 99 cents until I know if I like the book. But then I realized after I grabbed the sample, this is book two. I'm like, why? Why did you promote book two? Give me book one. Anyway, that was a tangent. Do you guys have any more thoughts on Amazon ads?
I do not. Nope.
All righty. Next question from John. Will people do newsletter swaps if your list is small? And how should authors go about finding people to do newsletter swaps with?
I would imagine that most authors do not care the size of the list. I mean, they're willing to, you know, help each other out. You know, go right ahead. And how to find out? Easy. You look them up and you ask them. You send them an email saying, hey, here's what I'm looking to do. You interested? Yes or no? And you'll find that most authors will be accommodating and say, sure, let's go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure that there are news authors who are like, I'm not going to do a swap for somebody with less than 10,000 addresses or something like that. But you're always going to find people who are willing to help you. Where you'll find those people, I mean, K-Boards is probably a place. You're going to probably find some good discussion on that sort of thing. And I'm sure if you, as Jeff said, if you actually single out some authors that you think that you actually have potential cross-audience with and ask them directly, you'll probably have an opportunity. I believe there are groups on Facebook for that sort of thing, although I can't conjure up the name of one off the top of my head. So there's my contribution.
All right. Well, I'm going to give the link to Patty Jensen's group because I know she loves getting a whole bunch of new people when when we share the link here. But if you Google on Facebook, SF/F cross promo bulletin board, that's the name of the group. And you can just go on there and say like, hey, I got a new release and I'm willing to promote your book in exchange for you promoting my book. And here's how big my list is. And you'll see there's a lot of that on there. Maybe watch and kind of see what people are saying before you jump in. Offer to promote some other people before you ask for something. I would say on Facebook, I see a lot of list snobbishness where people really aren't that interested in you promoting their stuff if you don't have 10,000 people on your list. And to a point, I understand because you want to get something in return if you're doing it. But a lot of these people built their list with InstaFreebie and they're really artificially 30 or 40,000 people rather than like, I would totally love somebody that has a list of 400 people that signed up from the back of their book for nothing, just because they're fans of that genre and that author, than my book going out to 20,000 people who only signed up for a newsletter to get something free. So it depends. I think you'll find it's kind of hard to go and ask an author that's real established with a big list, maybe. You might get more out of kind of looking for other people that are on the same level as you. And that's not always the case. I know we've had guests on who have made buddies with, you know, somebody that's a bigger name author out there and got him promoted. It's whatever your schmoozing skills are, I guess. And it's kind of hard to know ahead of time if the author is somebody that even does newsletter swaps. If you see, like, I would sign up for their newsletter and see what they're doing, to be honest. You won't see me generally doing them. And it's just because we've kind of talked about this on the show before. I don't really want to send out more newsletters than when I have a release, which is already once a month usually. And I'm not really big into plugging stuff I haven't read. And I beta read for some friends and I almost never just randomly read people's stuff. Every now and then I'll grab a sample and see, but you know, it's tough. Indie stuff can go either way. So I've gotten really wary about promoting anything that I haven't actually read. And I hardly have time to read stuff. I usually go for my traditionally published authors, to be honest. So that is my thoughts on that. Check out that promo group. There's a lot of people that are doing the newsletter swaps. And if you are going to approach somebody bigger, like I love that we had him on the show a while ago, Dale Ivan Smith. You know, he was out there for like 2 years on Twitter chatting with authors and kind of making friends. And before he published his books and before he asked anybody for anything, and I don't even know if he asked anybody really other. I think he has a couple urban fantasy people that he did ask. But I think that's kind of the way to do it, just to be out there and make buddies with people and not ask for anything until they actually know you and like you and invited you over for dinner. But that's that's all I have on that. Okay, getting towards the end, guys. Sue asks, I'm doing a box set soon of my first 4 books. Is that still the strong move in the market, or are readers chilling on that?
Well, that's been my experience, that box sets are still just as popular as ever. It's almost as if you find yourself an author that you're willing to follow and you're willing to enjoy and look up all the other works, it's like you're expecting to find a box set just to, like for instance, you can actually promote to members of your family, your friends. They're like, oh, man, I just found this great new author. Check out this box set. You know, he's got going on. Great price. You'll love it. I mean, I think it's a good thing still.
Yeah, I think a box set is still a good idea. You can price it higher and therefore you can do deeper discounts on it. It's a new entry point to your series. It's a new product, just another thing in your library. There's a dozen good reasons to do a box set and they don't really cost any real effort or money except for maybe if you do a fresh format and a new cover. So whether or not they're burning up the charts just because they're the new in thing, there's certainly still a useful thing to do.
I definitely do them and I will continue to do them. As Joe said, it's kind of like having another book one for the same series. You can do a different cover, do a different blurb, maybe attract a different audience, even though different people may have read your first blurb and go, eh, not for me, and read your second blurb and it just sounds like, oh, that's for them. They're technically the same audience, but they didn't know they were both your audience. So that's a way to do it from the marketing side. And you maybe have an easier time to get a book bub if you're discounting from like $9.99 or $7.99 all the way down to 99 cents. I would generally do the 99 cent thing if you have four more books in the series that they can go on and buy. I see less worth of doing it on a, like if it's a trilogy and it's complete and there's nothing else to lead them into. I'm not sure I would do the 99 cent thing. Try for a book bub. Yeah, maybe. I guess I have. That's a lie. I've totally done it. In my case, I had a audiobook and it really propelled the sales of the audiobook. So it was worth doing, even though
we appreciate your honesty.
I appreciate it. I have so many books out, I can't remember what I've done is what it is. But so are readers jaded? I feel like I'm seeing fewer of the giant multi-author box sets in the list these days. So maybe in for that kind of thing, there may be, you know, I still see them. It depends on how much the authors promo them and stuff. But I would say I'm seeing less of those dominating the list for, you know, a while there, maybe 2014, 2015, those were really popular. But from the same author, I actually have people that are like, why haven't you boxed up the rest of your series? I love box sets. So I think it's worthwhile. Okay, so we originally were going to have some questions from Chris Tickner as the heart of the show, but we've kind of gone over some of this stuff he asked, but I'll go ahead now. And I feel like these are things a lot of people are wondering about, the launching and rapid releases and how to get reviews. So I'll just kind of briefly talk about some of the things he's concerned about, and we can chime in if we have any more on it. So he's been writing since 2014. He's trying to do everything by the book for his release. He's got to do the best launches possible. Done the covers, professional editing. He used InstaFreebie to list build, using a 25,000 word sample as a free giveaway book for mailing list signups. It's not a prequel, he says, but a 1.5 in the series. And so he doesn't have a website yet. He doesn't want to pay for it. And I think that's fine. You know, or you can get a free Blogspot blog. I don't know. Does anybody actually have Blogspot anymore? You can get a free blog out there for temporary.
And can you get a free WordPress too?
Yeah. And even your own domain name and your own website can be like under $100 a year. But so he's about to launch three books together. And he was wondering about getting reviews, since most advertisers need reviews before they accept the first book, and he has none. So we'll start with there. He has all this, what should I do? Strategies like, okay, do I inform any reviewers 2 weeks to a month before to go to BookFunnel and download a free copy? In the agreement, they will leave an honest review on launch day. Does this count as verified reviews? No, it does not. They have to buy the book on Amazon. Or he says, should he do a soft secret free launch on Amazon 10 days before, making the book free, I think? Or maybe that I read that in the question. Or just do a launch at 99 cents and inform the list and hope for reviews before raising the price to $2.99. So it was a long email. The gist is, how do you get reviews when you're a new author launching your book for the first time? And I will say, you're probably not going to be able to get eReader News Today and Fussy Librarian and folks like that to do the launch reviews, because they want to see that you have a history of good solid reviews on older books if they are going to do a new release. That doesn't mean you can't try to get them like a month in or something after you do have reviews up there, or even a week in. They're usually booked out for a while though. So if you want to get them on launch week, you have to have emailed them like a month before you launch the book. And I think I mentioned before, you can put it up on Goodreads even if you're not going to do a pre-order on Amazon, and usually that's enough for them. But again, you have to have the history. They have to see that you've gotten good book reviews on other books. So yeah, I would just plan to basically give out a lot of free copies. Depending on who you're, do you have friends? Do you have a writer's group? Do you have any contacts out there yet? I did not. I had a critique group, but I couldn't ask people who critiqued my books to review it. So I really didn't have any fantasy people. So I just did my best as I could. And I submitted to a lot of the sites out there, which most of them at the time would not take self-published books. And I just found a lot of it was just kind of building them up over time. And that's not what you want to hear. But if you did manage to get that Insta freebie list from people who downloaded your 1.5 novella and liked it, definitely hit up those people. Those are probably your best chance for finding reviewers early on. And you can use BookFunnel to send them the book 2 weeks ahead of time. And just, yeah, you can definitely remind them what this is release day. If you could now go post a review, that would be great. I try not to put too much pressure on people. If they got a review copy, you can, if you want to, you can keep track of who actually posted reviews. It's up to you. It's more work, and you might get frustrated because not everybody will end up reviewing. But if you just give enough review copies out, maybe you'll get the 10 or 20. And that's really all you need. Like we were saying, you don't need hundreds. Like, it's great when you get to that point. But you, generally that happens as a result of having sold tens of thousands of books, not because you were hustling for reviews. So do you guys have any thoughts on this? We've kind of gone over it a little bit.
Well, I pretty much agree with all that. The only other thing I would say is, if you're looking for, you know, reviews and you're just starting out and like I say, you have no reviews and you want some, same sort of thing before. It's just, you know, try, you know, looking up other authors in your same genre and maybe in the same boat and say, hey, let's do like a be honest reviews for each other. If you don't like it, fine, write it and say so, but I'll review yours, you review mine, sort of thing.
That's going to get you in trouble. Don't do that. Amazon doesn't let you review other authors. That's the kind of stuff.
Is that something new? Because I did that when I first started.
Yeah, but that was 7 years ago, right?
God, going on 8, but yeah.
No, but yeah, they don't like that quid pro quo kind of thing, and they'll delete the reviews if they find out.
Oh, anti-M. Oh, we love them.
Just be really careful. That's anything that you don't want them to feel they're obligated. I have to give you 5 stars because you gave me 5 stars kind of thing, and because, you know, and then if the readers go read it and they don't like the book, they're harsher. Because here there were all these glowing reviews, right? You'll see this sometimes. Like, I don't know what the people were smoking that gave this book 5 stars, but. So I would just try to make sure you're going to get real honest reviews from the beginning. And you'll probably, you will get people that have read your stuff before. So they may be predisposed to like your books. But I would be really careful about anybody feeling obligated to give you a good review.
Yeah, I've had other people, you know, like first time authors saying, well, not, you know, giving a review, but like just beta reading and see what I think, and make it about 2-3 chapters in. I remember like, oh man alive, and like, okay, well, take this with a grain of salt, but here's what I found. And usually if it comes to that, or else if someone's asking me for a review and I just don't care for it, I just won't leave the review. I'm not that vindictive. So I really don't care for it. I'm not going to give, unless they really annoy the heck out of me. But I've only done it like once, and they deserved it, but it was a long time ago.
All right, Joe?
I don't think I got anything to add. I agree with your assessment that the if you have developed even a small list, doing giveaway, you know, offering free books to that list in exchange for honest reviews is probably your best bet. That's what I've done, and you'd be surprised. I mean, you'd be surprised at what sort of promotion you can get going with only, you know, a dozen or so reviews. I find generally I start when I'm looking for promotional opportunities, I tend to start looking once I have around 20 reviews, and you can get quite a few with that few. So, yeah.
Right. And I would, you know, be very free with your book. Like, don't be afraid to give away 100 copies of it. You know, maybe they would have bought it, maybe they wouldn't have. But I think I mentioned probably a couple years ago when I launched my first sci-fi series and was kind of new to that genre, I gave away 1,000 copies of the first book to my fantasy readers, which, because I was just hoping some of them would come over to the sci-fi and read the new series.
Come over to the dark side.
Yeah, well, and it sold really well. It had like no effect on the release. There were very little effect, it seemed to. So you'd be amazed. You can give away lots of free copies, and there's still way more people out there to sell.
That's a good point. If you're just starting out and you're looking for reviews, plan on giving away lots of copies.
And you'd actually be surprised how many people will still buy a copy even when they got one for free. Like, I have, again, I mentioned my review crew, a lot of them buy the books anyway, and I don't ask them to or require them to.
Yeah, practically every member of my posse, as I call them, yeah, they're just like, oh, we'll review them, we'll do the beta read as well, but yeah, we'll pick up a copy just as soon as it comes out. I'm like, fantastic, guys, I appreciate it. So.
And if you are launching 3 books, I think that was in there somewhere, then maybe free book one, just all around free, is an option you may consider. I mean, you could try launching it at 99 cents first, see how it does, see if it's getting reviews. But I actually did that when I launched my pen name from scratch a few years ago, is I wrote the first three. I made the first one 99 cents for the first week. But as soon as I had two ready to come out, I did the price match thing and dropped book one to free. And for a while I had book one free everywhere and the rest in KU. And that's a possibility because that's the only way you can make it free, permanent free or free for a month or whatever. And the other people will just see on the other stores that there are no more. It looks like there are no more. And if it was a complete story, they won't be pissed. Because in that case, it was a complete romance. And that was the end of that couple's journey. And so, I don't know. It depends on your genre, how much of a cliffhanger you have at book one. But it is a possibility to make book one free for a month if you have two more full-priced ones and you're not gaining the momentum you were hoping for at 99 cents. Because I think you mentioned launching at 99 cents and then raising to $2.99, perfectly valid strategy. And you can just swing it and see how it goes. I might not start free. I did because I had two more books ready to go at $3.99 or $4.99, I think they were. But it's really up to you. A lot of newer authors have a hard time giving stuff away for free, and I think that's understandable, especially if you took a long time to write it and you feel like I should get paid for this. But if you got two more waiting, you know, the more book ones you have out there, the more book two and three you're going to sell. That's just kind of how it works. All right, last question, also from Chris, kind of tying into all this, is if so say you are launching three books like that, but then you have a very small mailing list, about 100 people, and only about $1,000 for your advertising budget, and I think that's a lot, actually. I had nowhere near $1,000 when I launched my first book. So what would you do? And we kind of talked about this earlier. If this is your first series, you're probably not going to be able to get like the e-reader news today and the Fussy Librarian, some of those, until you do get some reviews. So a lot of places will, kind of the smaller places will take free books. They only charge like $5 or something for a site. It's iffy how many downloads you're going to get. But there's free book rankings, just like there's rankings in the regular paid store. So it can be worth it to pay a little to get some downloads of a free book. But yeah, like $1,000, I would be really careful about where you spend. You might not even want to spend that much till you kind of see how the book's doing. You could spend it really easily with Facebook ads, and I don't know. I wouldn't do Facebook ads probably to a book with no reviews yet. So here we are back to how do you get reviews first. Just be careful with your money. You may find that just investing the money in covers and trying to go real low budget, like the mailing list swaps we talked about, is something you can do without spending any money. Do you guys have any thoughts? Like, what would you do if you were just starting out and you didn't have a lot of reviews and you do have some money to spend on ads?
That's a damn good question. I mean, based on how everyone keeps talking about Facebook's ads or else with the AMS ads, I would probably dip my toe in that just to see how well I could make it work. Especially just now, it's focusing on the first book and not necessarily the second and third, because we want to get the first one. That's the series starter. Get that in everyone's hands.
Yeah, I think what I would do is once I had, you know, all three books out, especially if it was, you know, more or less a simultaneous release, is I would drop the price a little bit on the first one, probably do just a 99 cent on the first one, and then spend my time and money on getting proficient in AMS ads and probably the like pay-per-click style book club ads. I think that's what I would be spending my money on, to try to keep, not just to get sales going, but to see if I could gain the proficiency in keeping sales going, which would be very useful going forward.
And I agree. I think AMS ads is the most, you're going to get a good bang for your buck on that. You can play around with them. You're not going to spend a lot. It's pretty tough to actually spend hundreds of dollars on one ad campaign there. Whereas with BookBub, boy, you can burn through $1,000 like nothing. Facebook's pretty, if you're not really watching how much you're paying per click, you can pay a lot there too. But the Amazon ads, it's a little tougher to spend a ton of money. Usually if the cost per click is high, they're not going to show your ads very much because they figure basically this is not what people want to see. But yeah, so try AMS ads. That seems like a good way to go, and just do them on the first book and kind of monitor how it goes. And if you do the ads, I will make sure and put the link to the other interview we had back last summer that's all about Amazon ads, because that Was that Michael Cooper or sees Facebook ads? There's so many people. I think maybe it's Brian. I'll have to go look. I'll put the link
in
the show
notes. This is number 175. We can't possibly expect to remember everything.
Right. This is 175, and I will put the link to the show with somebody we interviewed who was very smart. Smarter than us, which doesn't take that much.
Clearly.
So yeah, probably AMS ads would be a good way to go. And then get your Facebook page, author page started too. You can play around with boosting posts on release week to your fans. And there's also the option of targeting people who might be your fans that are your target audience. But just be careful. Facebook's so easy to spend a lot of money. Same with BookBub.
BookBub is horrendous. Holy cow. It's great service, but wow.
Well,
be prepared to have the defib kit right next to you when you're like, I'll see how much this one's going to cost. Clear.
Well, I would take it in a second if you can get one of their sponsored posts. That's, even if it's $700, you're going to earn that back. But the CPM, I think they have the option of pay-per-click, CPM, whatever. Lots of acronyms. Boy, you can spend a lot. And you can... We've had people on the show that are making a lot, so it's possible, but just be careful if you've got a budget there. All right, so that's been over an hour of blabbing. I'm tired. You guys are probably tired of listening to us. Do you have any final thoughts? Do you have anything out you guys want to tell people about?
Not that I haven't already mentioned. Let's say, you know, next mystery's out, working on the next fantasy. I've got 3 audiobooks in production, so things are going pretty good.
I guess I've already mentioned everything that I need to mention. I think my most recent book release is The Stump and the Spire. Came out on the 27th. That's a pair of short stories, so if you want to buy that, go ahead. But other than that, just what I gave in my news in the beginning.
All right, and I'm kind of between stuff. I have a book 8 in my Dragon Blood series coming out soon, but that's been written for a while and is on a pre-order. So we'll see how that does. I have no expectations for a book 8. It was just, I was enjoying listening to the audiobooks for some reason it's easier to listen to my own stuff on audiobook than it is to read it. I just get really critical when I'm reading stuff. So that's coming out, and then I'll let you guys know whatever I decide on for my summer project, and I'll talk about launch strategies and whatever once there's been a launch. But in the meantime, go to episode 175 on marketingsff.com, or just come by the site and search for Amazon ads, and I'll make sure that link is in there, as well as whatever notes we talked about today. Thanks for listening, everyone.
All right, you guys, take it easy. Till next week.
So long, everybody.